It's a beautiful day in the Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis, and we meet and greet you from our studios here at 106.5 Freedom FM, downtown Bastia. And we welcome you to Issues St. Kitts and Nevis for today. I'm your host, Juni Liburd, going to be here until 3 o'clock. And as promised, since yesterday, I think we posted on our website that young Konris Maynard, the new St. Kitts-Nevis Labour Party representative for constituency number 3, is our special guest on Issues. And he's here, came early, and so it's time to meet and greet young Konris Maynard. Good afternoon, Konris.
Good afternoon, Juni, and how are you?
I am excellent. And yourself?
Well, I'm doing well. I want to send a special good afternoon to the listening public in Radio Land, around the Federation, and more specifically now the constituents of number 3 in West Bastia, who have made it clear that they are proud again. Mm-hmm. We are here to win big for them. So we want to big up all the constituents of the area, especially the young persons as well, who have been sending me some messages and so on, the young Labour picnic them, etc. It's a good time in West Bastia now, and we're feeling good again. We're feeling proud again.
Now, you made a dramatic and very dynamic speech when you were... People said it was your launch, but I know it wasn't the launch. It was your introduction to the constituency number 3 constituents, really,
yes.
The people from that area. And you made a very dynamic presentation. I mean, we played it here on Freedom FM a couple of times on Issues on Good Morning, St. Kitts and Nevis. And in it, you mentioned that you want to win big for the people. How do you intend to win big for the people, basically? I mean, the speech was so refreshing. It's a long time because the speech tended to cover all areas, all facets of life in West Bastia, if you will, and the role you intend to play for the people of West Bastia.
Indeed. Well, Juni, as you would know, you've known me a very long time. I am from the belly of West Bastia and the belly of labor in the area. From my grandfather, as I said, who was a cane cutter, a very, very, very staunch labor supporter. And from my grandparents, they passed down what it meant to be a part of the labor movement. And on Thursday, what we saw was, as you correctly stated, only an introduction of the new candidate to the constituents of the area. It was a special branch meeting where we invited all constituents. Everyone was welcome to come and share in this particular meeting, where the branch executive can, for the first time, formally introduce the candidate to the people of the constituents. It was by no means a launch, and it's telling that some persons want to term it as a launch. I wonder what they're going to say
when the real launch comes. Now, one of the things, Konris,
yes,
that already people on the other side critiquing that meeting was saying that, oh, it was a special, exclusive meeting for just special interest groups.
Right.
What do you say to that?
Well, let's clear it up. You would know that we sent out a press release stating very clearly that it was a branch meeting for the branch executive to introduce the new candidate to the constituents, and that all were invited. We didn't send out any invitations. There weren't any special groups that were invited. It was for anyone in the constituency who wanted to come and be a part of the
branch. Whether they were PAM, PLP, Labour.
Anyone could have come. Yes, it's very similar to what has happened. It's part of the process. There's a process, of course. There's this election process where, names are put forward. In our case, scientific polls done, interviews conducted, the national executive meets. It says, in consultation with the branch, they make a decision on who the nominee would be. Then you accept that nomination. and then you introduce yourself to the branch, you know, the constituents who have rooted for you to be there. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, I haven't spoken on the platform yet, and in time, mm-hmm. at appropriate time, we will have the launch. And, you know, as you say, a lot has been made about this, and people have tried to coin it in their own way. But that is what we expect.
You expect that
yeah. is the politics they are accustomed to. So we expect that will happen. But in no uncertain terms, and those who were there know that everyone was invited, as the press release and the bulletin and the information sent to the press, that it was for everyone, all constituents, mm-hmm. to attend the branch meeting. They have even gone as far as to compare that branch meeting of the introduction of a single candidate on the Labour ticket to the launch of the unity construct. Mm-hmm. We feel honored that they are comparing the yeah. introduction right. of a single candidate to the launch of an entire unity construct. And so, you know, we like what we're seeing based on the type of response. But in no uncertain terms, it was not exclusive by any measure, by any means, mm-hmm. and all was welcome. And that is going to be how we are going to move forward in West Bastia, where we are going to be an all, everyone is inclusive, mm-hmm. Included, whether you are formerly a PAM or PLP or, you know, a dormant Labour or non-supporter. We believe that representation must be for all. And so our message is going to be to ensure that we cover all of West Bastia. West Bastia is proud again, and I want to win big for everybody.
Excellent.
And it really doesn't matter what your affiliation is. And I think I've shown that throughout my life, that I, you know, I haven't just spoken of unity and love. You know, I've lived it.
True.
You know, I my friends, the people have interactions with and so on, come from all aspects of the political sphere. So it's really an honor, Juni, that we have taken up this this noble cause, mm-hmm. and really take on what I think is a dropped baton from Sir Franz to now really address the needs of the constituents of West Bastia.
Now, that theme, winning big for the constituents of West Bastia, reverberates, mm-hmm. and I could see that being a central facet in your campaigning going forward. But I want to ask you a question here. First of all, let me just say I'm very honored to be having you here. I know in the past you've come here several times and Sugar Bowl, when you were in the Calypso, I know you're still a Calypsonian. We'll come
yes,
to that.
Yes, I will always be a Calypsonian.
You'll always be a Calypsonian. I know you've been here in the past mornings with Sugar Bowl and his Morning Express and everything, when you're putting out all your songs. But I want to deal with the political arena. Mm-hmm. What piqued your interest? What got you motivated from the start? I know you grew up in a political family. Mm-hmm. You've been in the bowels of labor, as you say, from birth. Mm-hmm. And your father is a very close friend and advisor to the Prime Minister, your father being Lincoln Maynard, who is or was also a Calypsonian of some merit.
But still is.
Still is, still tries, okay. I want to ask you, what got you motivated to enter politics, to be a candidate now? You said that the baton that Sir Joseph Franz carried proudly has been dropped, and I think this is in reference to Mr. Sam Conder. But what got you motivated to enter the political arena?
Well, Juni, this goes back a very, very long time. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always shown a keen interest in the affairs of my country. And at a young age, I've always been involved in community activities. Even before now, a lot of community activities as a little boy growing up. I was part of the youth parliament. The first sitting of the first ever youth parliament debate in the National House of Assembly, being a part of debate groups and so on. I've always had a keen interest in the affairs of my country. Mm-hmm. And one avenue which I sought to expound on those issues was through Calypso. That was one avenue in which I thought I could make a reasonable contribution because I felt that it was needed. God had blessed me with that particular talent. And I said, you know, this is something I can continue doing in terms of my contribution to the further development of my country. So the need to serve, the need to be of service to my country as a whole, and the people of West Bastia is long-standing. It is not something that has happened overnight. So it has always been something that I have considered where, you know, maybe one day I may have to answer to how can I contribute at a higher level in terms of the development of the country and the people, especially in West Bastia. And so when the calls were made, in terms of the people reaching out and saying, Konris, we have sacrificed a lot. We had put, we had allowed, for example, we understood that we may not have been getting the best representation, but for the bigger cause of the labor movement, we sacrificed a tremendous amount. And we took a little when we should have gotten more, and we stayed a bit quiet because we looked at the overall picture of the whole country. But they have said, this is our time now. This is West Bastia's time now. And we have sacrificed enough. And we need to have a fresh outlook on what the future holds. And we think that you might be somebody who can help us to do that. And so when that call came out, it was almost impossible for me to say no, because of that yearning I've had for all time to see everyone in my community have the type of opportunities that others have been blessed with. You know, from whatever issue it is, land ownership, home ownership. I have a special interest in small businesses and young people advancing themselves that way. I believe that we should be feeding ourselves more. We have some of the best land I can say the world, and that is indicative of when, in the time of slavery, they chose here to be one of the major places where sugar was grown because we had such fertile land. In fact, that is what some of the words that the Caribs called here explain. Yes, that we are a fertile land. And so I believe very, very seriously that we should be feeding ourselves. I believe also that we should be supplying a majority of our energy. There's no reason why we should not be investing in that. And so when the people of West Bastia called, in terms of housing, agriculture, small business, and so on, youth empowerment, cultural expressions, to be able to show our culture and our arts, music, etc. You know, it was very hard for me to say no, because this is what I've seen that may be something that I can really lend a hand to.
All right, it's 1:57. My guest, the new St. Kitts-Nevis Labour Party representative for constituency number 3, King Konris Maynard, here with us this afternoon on issues. Is your Calypso career over?
My Calypso career is not over. I have not, I'm sure you haven't heard me say I resign from Calypso.
But with the politics, assuming you win.
Assuming I,
assuming you win when elections are called.
Yes.
Would that put an end to your to your Calypso career, or do you see yourself engaging from time to time in Calypsos?
Well, the assumption is a good one, assuming I will win. You know, that's a very good one. And so when we get to that point, we will, well, I will evaluate whether or not, you know, competition probably might be a little here and there, because I don't know if it has happened before. I think, though, I've done some research, and I think it may have happened in other countries where a minister or a government official engaged in calypso competition. But that's something that we could look at. Remember, I have a very, very large book of songs, which I haven't released yet.
Imagine.
And I think it would be a tremendous waste for some of them because, you know, they're not finished yet.
Your dad could always sing them for you.
But I don't know if he could handle this stage. No, he's, you know,
he's moving on.
I know he's exercising and so on, but, the pace might be a little too stiff
hectic
for him. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, let's look at constituency number three. You have inherited from the late Sir Joseph Nathaniel France, the Honorable Sam Conder, who has been parliamentarian for over 25 years. He's been in the representative for constituency number three. What makes you better for that constituency? I know you've been around campaigning. You've been door-to-door. What kind of reception have you gotten? And what are some of the how do you intend to make constituency number three better for the people of that area?
Right. Well, Juni, if you, as I've said, you can always look at a person's track record,
yes,
in their life and what they have put their hands on, mm-hmm, and what type of results they have achieved. Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to be very clear who of the choices that the people of West Bastia have, who can deliver and who has always delivered without excuses. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's going to, and we're going to make the case very loud and clear, that I know and understand what it is to win. Mm-hmm. And I have now decided that I want to win big for the people of West Bastia. So a number of things and so on. I'm obviously a very young candidate.
Yeah, because you're 30 years old.
I'm 30 years old.
But Sam Conde is more than twice your age.
Right. And oftentimes, mm-hmm, what you find is the times can move past and ideas can become a bit old, mm-hmm, and dated. What we offer now in Constituency 3 is a genuinely new perspective on how things can be done, and a different type of tenacity surrounding getting these things done. We want to engage, you know, young persons and old persons alike to ascertain from them as well a number of things that they would like to see. And we are going to work together to make sure that these things can actually happen. From my speech, as you could see, there are novel things that we want to look at. We want to look at, for example, the agro-tourism business. We can not only look about growing food and doing livestock for ourselves, but for the region, and push forward in that. We want to look at things like health tourism, for example, where we can promote our constituency and by extension the country as a place where you can come for wellness, you know, natural treatments, etc. We also want to look at tourism in a sense where there are a lot of things in our constituency that we can be proud of, mm-hmm, that shows the advancement of the people. For example, the Buckley's riot. Mm-hmm. There's no reason, for example, why that cannot be a site that people, for example, come in as on day sales, can have a tour to tour Buckley's. Mm-hmm. Also, what about farms that we can have that tourists can come and visit farms and so on. And there are wide array of ideas which we are going to bring that are fresh and novel. And also the way in which we deal with long-standing issues. We are not going to come with a politics of division. We're going to come up with the politics of inclusion. Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to be very clear who is going to be able to deliver on their words. We had someone who has been, as you said, there for quite some time. And the issue may be pushed that experience matters. But I'll tell you a little story about experience. Mm-hmm. there is this gentleman who went to work. He was, let's call him a young engineer, and he worked there for 2 years. And there was this older guy who, you know, worked well, and he worked there for 20 years. And one day the guy with 2 years experience told the elder guy, you know, we need to do this a little different. And the elder guy, what do you know? You know, you're only here 2 years. I've been here 20 years. Mm-hmm. And the young fellow looked at him and said, yes, I may have 2 years experience, but you have 21-year experiences. And so not because you have years of experience means that you have the experience doing the right thing. Because if you did, I would not have a chance, because then you would have addressed the issues surrounding the area. Mm-hmm. So whatever the problem was, whatever the issue was that prevented you, you can say that there was some failure. I'm not planning to fail, mm-hmm. you know, and I understand what it takes to go out, get things done, and win. So at the end of the day, I think my track record will show that if I decide that this is something that I'm going to be in, that I am going to win big for the people of West Bastia.
All right. It's just about 5 minutes after two, and we are going to give you a chance. I know you're anxious to speak with Konris Maynard, the new St. Kitts-Nevis Labour Party representative for constituency number 3, but not just yet. A couple more questions, and then we're going to open the lines. I want to get your take on a couple of issues, and I want you to... I know you could go on and deal with these issues in length and in depth, but I just want to get from you your take on certain issues. Now, the Prime Minister has been seen, especially in recent times, by the Honorable Sam Conder, Dr. Timothy Harris, the unity construct, to be dictatorial. Recently, he's an illegitimate government, or he's heading an illegitimate government according to the construct. And they're saying that the motion of no confidence is now 10 months and it has not been introduced. It has not been debated. And this is a blow for democracy. I want to know, what is your take on these comments from the opposition parliamentarians, the unity construct, about the Prime Minister as a dictator and presiding over an illegitimate government and taking so long to deal with the motion of no confidence? What are your gut feelings on this? How do you see all of this unfolding as the new candidate?
First of all, we must never forget to commend people of public service for the tremendous work that they have done. The Honorable Prime Minister has done significant work for the advancement of the cause of the people in St. Kitts and Nevis. I think that goes without saying. So much so that it has been recognized the region over and the world over. Only recently, we had one of the most popular presidents in the history of the United States commend the effort of
You're
the right
referring to President
yes,
Bill Clinton.
President Bill Clinton referred to the efforts of our small little country, Prime Minister Dr. Denzel Douglas, who was the impetus for what is now the Clinton Global Initiative,
yes,
in order to bring relief to the cost of HIV and AIDS medicines around the world. So we see and we must commend persons for the outstanding service that has happened. I think that is without question. Even people I speak to, they always caveat it with that you know, we know that he's good at this and so on. And there are wonderful qualities. I'm not going to sit and say that everybody is perfect or that any particular person is perfect. People have their varying styles, etc. And so you reach to a point where people are calling him now a dictator. Now, although I'm very young, I still am a student of history. And my history shows me that the Right Honorable Sir Robert Llewellyn Bratcher was also called a dictator. And he was called even worse things. Mm-hmm. And there were, you know, all manner of things to make sure that this gentleman failed. The same people who called Mr. Bratcher, and Sir Bratcher, our first national hero, a dictator. The same people are now today praising the efforts of Sir Robert Llewellyn Bratcher.
True.
So I will not be surprised if in a short time from now, the same people who are making these arguments change their tune because he has now retired from public office. And so remember, as I said in my speech, they have to find negative things to say. And I am not aware, I can be corrected, of any case where most of what the opposition is said has been proven in any court of law or in anything like that to substantiate a lot of the claims that they have. And so in my experience in knowing the gentleman for quite some time and knowing people closely who work with him, view him as a very strong character. And you have to admire that. And people have their varying styles. But I have not found reasonable people who have worked with him who can concur on this summation of the distinguished gentleman. Mm-hmm. And so we must be careful with the labels and not just do it out of a political convenience. I thought they have said that they want a new type of politics, but they're still playing the old type of games. Let's have a sit down and discuss very clearly the issues affecting us now and which team can carry us in the right and better direction in the future. You also mentioned that the government, and they are claiming that the government is illegal.
Mm-hmm.
There is much to be debated on that, but I think it is very telling that if it were illegal, they should have a very, very strong case in the court. Mm-hmm. And they have since withdrawn that and have now taken that out of the picture. And so the government, in my view, is not illegal, because it can operate within the constraints of the Constitution at present. If it was clearly illegal, they would waste no time in making sure that the courts had a say on that. So, and I will leave that for the legal minds to debate, as each would have their varying sides.
Mm-hmm.
And I addressed in the speech as well the motion of no confidence. If the speaker chooses to table it, the prime minister has a number of options. He has two options, really. He can see the debate through, or he can call an election.
Yes.
I think, though, that debate brings some other things to the fore. I voted in the last election for the Honorable Sam Conder in number 3. I voted for him as a Labour Party candidate.
Mm-hmm.
I did not vote for him to bring the life of this government to an end. And that is the sentiment that I'm hearing across the constituency. So if we are saying, for example, that yes, we understand that there should be comprehensive, in my view, constitutional review and reform, but it must cover everything. It must not just cover things that are beneficial to you. I do not believe it is right that on January morning, people decide that we want a Labour government. That is the last time the electorate spoke to us. They said very clearly, by almost 60%, I think it was, in St. Kitts, that we want a Labour government. Less than 3 years later, because of whatever personal reason, someone decides to take up my votes and take them over to a side which I absolutely rejected. Not that I'm saying they are bad. I decided that I did not want that. I did not give the representative a mandate to change my vote.
So your thoughts on this matter, Konris, are that perhaps the right way to have done it would have been to have a by-election in that constituency, number 3, so that whoever would be elected would have a mandate. If Sam Conder was re-elected, then it would mean that would give him a mandate to go and implement the changes and go on the PLP side and have a motion of no confidence, et cetera, et cetera. Because as you indicated, you did not give him your vote to do what he's doing now.
Correct. And that is certainly an option, a by-election. And certainly, I guess, if it were me and I was convinced that this is what the people wanted, that would have been certainly something on the cards. Because in my summation or in my review of this whole situation, I cannot recall the people of West Bastia grouping up, going on maybe Patsy Allers and saying, Sam Conder, we need you to change our votes. I don't recall that happening at no time. And so we need to be careful that we respect the processes. And what this tells us is that we really need to have a serious look at constitutional reform. And we also have to evaluate whether this seemingly shortcoming of the constitution was not necessarily specifically by design to prevent persons from bringing what is a legally selected government to an end prematurely. So I believe that we should have a proper debate on complete constitutional reform. But I do not support that my representative will vote against the government which I voted for only just 3 years ago. Only just 3 years ago. And we never grouped up. We never demanded, we never shouted that we need you to change. Let us decide. In a true democracy, I believe that at the end of the day, the people must be the ones to decide. It cannot be because you have woken up on the wrong side of the bed, or you're feeling sad, or you're feeling down because you're not getting something that you want, and you can decide to do that. And so the people of West Bastia have said it clearly as I've walked through the constituency and around, that we did not ask anybody to move our votes. We want to decide that ourselves. And at the end of the day, I think that is where it's going to go, where the people will be the ones who decide who forms the next government, not a few men.
Now, this is the final question I want to ask you for now, and then we're going to open the lines. During your highly motivated, successful speech, you mentioned that the unity construct is on a path to self-destruct. You said that the CCM, the PAM, and the PLP were on a collision course. Now, what do you mean by that, and how do you see the unity construct?
Right.
Now, as a political entity.
Yes. No, I have no problem with unity at all. You know, you can unite for whatever reasons you want in life. And these gentlemen, distinguished gentlemen, have decided that they want to unite in some, you know, very complicated way. Because, you know, they're saying they're united on one front but different in another front and so on. In a very complicated way that they're united. My take is that they're united against Douglas. That's my opinion. Because to me, this was never formed out of something that the people originally initiated. This was out of because, you know, other reasons, I think, for some nefarious reasons as well, that that is how it sprung up. So I have no problem with them uniting for a cause. What is clear to me is that the cause is against Douglas, and that is not a cause I'm willing to support at this time, because I think that a cause should be much greater than just tearing down one man. It should be about elevating the masses, and so I stand on that premise. Now, when I say that it is poised to self-destruct, it's basically in life we have never seen anything that lasts without some underlying strong philosophy, right? Whether it is the Labour Party, there is a philosophy that will continue after I have gone, and that was there before I was here. So it doesn't depend on who is in the makeup, the philosophy, and the core principles remain the same. So when men break down, when men begin to tear themselves apart, the one thing that will pull it back together is that underlying philosophy. I have yet to find the underlying philosophy of the unity construct that is being proposed. Take away the leadership of Dr. Douglas. What is the underlying principle? Constitutional reform. Well, that could be finished in a few months. What then after that? Is it then electoral reform? That will also finish in a few months. So I am missing, and I'm a keen student of looking at, you know, trends and philosophies and analyzing, you know, vibes and energies and so on. And yes, right now there is a chorus of people who decide that, who have decided that they are not supporting the Right Honorable Prime Minister. And as I said, people have the right to do that. They have the right to voice their opinions against the Prime Minister. But I'm just saying that to me, and they have expressed to me privately as well, that that's basically what it's about. We'll do this to get rid of the Honorable Prime Minister, and then we'll go our separate ways. And so I cannot support a philosophy like that. And that is why I think, and I think the people of number three have clearly said that since 1946, to be precise. They have always said that we believe in the philosophy of the Labour Party. We believe in the core tenets of the labor movement, and we will decide when we are going to change that. And from the feeling and energy that I'm getting on the ground, they are still strongly supporting what is the labor movement.
All right, it is just about 20 minutes after 2 o'clock. My guest, Konris Maynard. We're going to come back with your calls right after this short break. It is now just about 22 minutes after 2 o'clock, and I was just sharing with Konris about the 10-year-old from the village of Halfway Tree. The young man, 10-year-old, a young child, shouldn't say young man, it's a young child, a young boy, 10 years old, who was found dead earlier today, Konris.
Yes, Junior, I was unaware of this because I've had some meetings this morning, so I ran out to come to this this meeting with you. I want to just extend my condolences. This is really, really tragic, it seems, and very sad indeed. And I hope the community coalesces around the family and provides as much support as possible, as they will obviously need it in this time. So I want to extend my condolences to the family and the people of the area. And with God's help, I hope they can see a brighter day in the future.
All right. It's 23 minutes after 2 o'clock. Issues with Konris Maynard. We're gonna go to the telephone. I just want to remind you of the lines are working and really ringing off the hook, as we say. The numbers are 465-6474. You can also reach us at 662-1065. That's 662-1065. Or if you're overseas, you can use our overseas line, which is 305. That's 305-515-3099. Let me just repeat them again for you. Locally, 662-1065. That's 662-1065. Or 465-6474. Or 305-515-3099. Let's go straight to the telephone and take our first caller. Good afternoon, caller. Thanks for waiting.
Good afternoon to you, Juni.
Good afternoon, Terry. How are you today?
I am pretty much fine, trying to raise my head above the water.
And I'm sure that you will do well at that. You're a fighter.
And good afternoon to Konris himself.
Pleasant good afternoon to you too, sir.
Konris.
Yes, sir.
At your acceptance launch.
It was not a launch, sir.
It was a launch, Konris. We're not going to play with semantics. You know I like you, but we'll not play with semantics. It was a launch because I saw people from St. Paul's, Central, and East. Nevertheless, Konris, your well-crafted speech, something that takes me aback. And when I look at it and listen to it and read through it, I said, one, you're looking towards leadership of the Labour Party, which is not bad. And you were talking about change. You talk about the motion of no confidence. You also indicated that you're not going to be a yes man. And you said to the Prime Minister to call the election. I don't believe the Prime Minister enjoyed when you said that called the election, because I believe, just as you believe, he should call the election. But most importantly, you said something, you know, Konris. And I want you, if at any time onwards, to continue saying this. You will support your peers when they are right. But when they are wrong, you will tell them that they are wrong, from the Prime Minister down upwards. And I totally agreed with that. You speak to constitutional change. And that is something which is needed, very much needed. And so, Konris, in your new future, whatever you intend to do, I want to wish you well. Because you are a young man that I like, but I do believe, Konris, you have taken the political stage at the wrong time. Have a nice day.
All right, thank you, Mr. Adams. What I would like to commend you for is your ability to get in first. I think that is a very good skill you have, and I want to commend you for that. And perhaps we could talk, because you may have skills that we can use as we further development of this country. Now, you mentioned a few things, and I've taken some notes, looking towards leadership. I am a young fella. I'm new in this, and I certainly can wait for those things. I don't need it now at all. And that is not something that is first and foremost in my mind. I want to be a leader for the people of constituency number 3. And I will do everything in my power to ensure that I win big for constituency number 3. And that is very premature. And I understand, as a political mind, where you're trying to lead with that. But that has no warrant at this time. You also said that I said that the Prime Minister should call the election. What I said is that the people of West Bastia have told me that they did not ask anyone to take their votes and put them across the political aisle. They want to be the ones to decide who is in and out of government. And on that basis, they don't want for someone else to decide that. They want to be the ones to decide that. And so they have told me that they are ready at any time for when the Prime Minister is ready to call the election. Now, you mentioned also the wrong time. Now, I have a fundamental problem with that, and let me tell you why. The people of West Bastia have reached out. They have said that we have sacrificed a lot, and we need from fresh ideas, a new face, a new person to win big for us. And they have reached out, and they have said, Konris, we think that you have a lot to offer. And we are seeing different times, different kettle of fish, different rough seas. I think it would have been really remiss of me and very bad of me to tell the people, you know, it's a bad time. Let me wait until the waters get smoother. If I were to come around then, I think they should just disregard me. And so I do not maintain that it is a wrong time. Sometimes you don't know what the great Lord above was preparing you for. And throughout my life, I've shown that, you know, I want to get things done. And I think maybe some persons have seen that and it has resonated with them. And so they have called and they've reached out and they said, despite your youth, we feel that you have the right type of experience to win big for us. And so I think it is a brilliant time for the people of West Bastia to now chart a different course and feel proud again, because somebody who knows and understands about really winning and winning by lengths to come and win big for them. So thank you, Terry Adams, for calling in. And I commend you on your strategy of getting in the first call.
Let's take another call. Good afternoon. Issues.
Good afternoon, Mr. Liburd. How are you?
Excellent. Yourself?
I'm doing fine.
You have a question or comment for Konris?
Good afternoon, Mr. Maynard.
Good afternoon. And how are you today?
I'm doing fine.
That's wonderful.
I'm in Warner.
Hi, Verlin.
Number three.
Yes, I thought I recognized the voice. How are you?
I'm doing okay.
Wonderful.
It's a bit of cold, but, you know.
Well, we...
two questions.
Yes.
One, constituency number three has always been a constituency, basically, that is always divided. It's always...
All right, we seem to have lost that call. It seems to have dropped out.
Yes,
Verlin,
please
call
try.
Us back.
Please try and
all right,
and
465-6474. Let's take this call. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon, Hunks.
Good afternoon, Konris.
Good afternoon, sir. And how are you?
Just listening on my four wheels, listening to the program.
That's wonderful.
Just listening on my four wheels now. Konris, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I heard you said something about elected representative. Everybody vote for a candidate. Mm-hmm. Some people, and I mean, thousands of people vote for a candidate. Different reason. Some vote for the candidate. Some vote for the party. Now, when that candidate representation in the National Assembly, he representing all the people. And if I vote for the candidate for, because of the party, so I vote for the party, not the candidate. But I vote some people who vote for the candidate. Now, who he going to represent them? How are you going to share the representation between them? Because you're saying that what Sam do, he should go back to the people. Because you vote for Sam for the party. Not for Sam, you vote for the party, not for Sam. So then, what about the fellow who vote for Sam? And he vote for the party. Because you got some people who vote for the candidate, the individual person.
But Hunks, the candidate was in a particular party.
Yes.
So you're voting for the party and not for the candidate per se.
Junior, but that's the point I'm trying to get across.
Right.
Because...
If I could just get in...
Canvas said he voted for the candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But you got people who don't vote for the party.
They vote for the candidate.
For the candidate. Because people vote for different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Some people vote for a drink of rum. Some people vote for some money.
Mm.
Or a cell phone.
Okay.
I'm saying that the candidate must represent all the people, even them who vote for the cell phone and vote for drink of rum. He must represent all the people.
All right.
Whatever the candidate does in the National Assembly,
mm-hmm.
he represents all the people.
I just wanted to ask him a question
before. The people are not satisfied with his representation.
Okay, Congress is willing to respond to you now.
Next time around, they'll vote him out.
Okay, thank you so much, Hunks. Konris?
Yes, what would be helpful from the caller is to tell me how many voted for him as a candidate.
How would he know that?
Precisely. And so...
These people represented a party when they went to...
Correct.
Before the
And
the
that
polls.
Is how they sold themselves.
Right.
They didn't sell themselves as an independent.
Right.
Now, clearly, if Sam or anyone, or a representative, as people have done in our election process, stated that I am independent, then people would have given him an independent mandate.
Right.
But the people of Constituency 3 gave the honorable representative a Labour mandate. It said,
yes.
Although, for example, you may not be the quickest one on the line and you're not going to finish strong for us, we are seeing the bigger picture. And because we understand and the struggle of the Labour movement comes from within number three, from all the way back in 1946, well, 1932 when the Workers' League was created, etc., we believe in this movement and we are supporting you because you're a part of this movement. You can test that. It's very easy to test that. You can go to the polls.
All right. Let's take another call here. Good afternoon, caller. You're on Issues with Konris Maynard.
Hey, blessed greetings, homie.
Blessed love.
Greetings to the young gentleman and to our listeners.
Yes.
Now, Mr. Maynard, in your opening statement, you made you used a phrase saying that some people say that in West Bastia, the present representative had dropped the baton. Was that what you said?
No, I said that the baton has been dropped. Yes.
Okay then.
And that I was referring to my speech, and where I got this is really from walking through the constituency, where people felt that it was not a continuation of the service that they had gotten for almost 43 years under the distinguished gentleman in Sir France.
Sir France, bless it. Sir France, as you know, is one of our national heroes, as is the Right Honorable Robert Bradshaw.
Correct.
And both of these gentlemen, it would seem to me, would always have stood on the side of the people in terms of retaining our heritage, our lands.
Right.
So therefore, I want to know how you come up with the term as dropping the baton when this gentleman, Mr. Kanda, mm-hmm. is in fact carrying on this tradition of retaining the lands as inheritance. You know, just a little diversion. We are speaking here recently of a lot of things like concerning reparations. Mm-hmm. You've heard of it, I believe.
Right.
And we are seeking to get justice for the hundreds of years of labor that our forebears provided and was not paid for. And I believe that part of that inheritance is the lands which were left to our people.
Right.
And Conrad France and Conrad Bradshaw would never, mm-hmm. ever, I believe, sanction any giving up of those lands on behalf of our people. So therefore, I want to know how you reconcile that and the statement about dropping the baton. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
All right, thank you, Colin.
Very interesting question. First of all, no one has given up any land in St. Kitts. No one has given up any land in St. Kitts. It has been a well-crafted debate by the opposition because people are very sensitive about our land, and rightly so. We fought very hard in 1975, finally Bradshaw acquiring the Sugar Lands. But I would have a hard time believing, for instance, that the Honorable Comrades would want us to just have our land and, you know, look at our land. What I would like to say in this regard is they got those lands for those lands to work for us. And that is what has happened in this scheme. The land has been working for the development of St. Kitts. And if you look closely, that is what actually has happened with the land. So I bring up these particular questions. For example, there is a university down at in my constituency, West Bastia. My question to you, should we have not allowed Ross University to build there, to bring a university here? Should we have said, no, we want to keep our lands? Maybe even the Marriott and other things. Now, so for example, you know, so I want to understand clearly what exactly we are saying when it comes to giving up our lands. That is the furthest thing from the truth. As far as I know, unless someone can point me differently, the land belongs, especially right now, to St. Kitts and Nevis, because as far as I understand, the National Bank is a St. Kitts and Nevis bank, and they have worked out an arrangement where some debt which was used for the development of the country can be retired by swapping it with the land. And, you know, I want to have an honest and true debate about this. And I believe in keeping our patrimony and making sure that it works for the people. But when we are going to make this, I think, very skewed argument about what a very small percentage of our land has done in terms of developing the country, I think we need to be careful. And I think it's unfortunate that we cannot have, because of varying political interests, an honest talk about what the land has done for us. And I think it's significant. And I think over time, history will show that it was a very, very good thing to look at how we can make the land work for us. So we have to be very careful about this. We need to ensure that our land always works for the better of the people, right? Because, for example, I spoke about, in my speech, a sizable university. Suppose that sizable university is going to come and bring 10,000 students to our shores, who is going to spring an economic boom in the area. Are you telling me I should deny them the opportunity to do that? So we have to be very careful at how we look at these things with respect to the land, and not necessarily fall for everything that is said. And I welcome we can have a further debate on this because it's very sensitive to us, and I think we're very wary of anything to do with our land, and we must be careful about it.
All right, Konris Maynard on issues 20 minutes before 3. The lines are open until 3 o'clock. We're going to ask you to try, in the interest of time, to make your comments and questions brief, and so that Konris can take as many calls for the next 20 minutes. Let's try an overseas call. Good afternoon, caller.
Hi, good afternoon, Juni. How are you doing today?
Good day.
Valti here.
Okay, Valti.
Okay, and good afternoon to Mr. Maynard, King Maynard.
Pleasant good afternoon to you.
I have a question for Mr. Maynard, and I don't want anyone to get very upset on my question, because apparently sometimes when we ask questions, people get upset. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. My question, first I want to make a statement. You left the Federation and you went to Tortola to live. And by right, everyone do have the right to leave the Federation to better themselves abroad. You were well paid, as I was made to understand that you were well paid in Tortola. And now you have left Tortola and you come back, I will assume, to serve the Federation as a candidate in constituency number 3 to be represent for the Labour Party. Now, what inspired you to leave a good paying job in Tortola and come into St. Kitts and not guaranteed a job in St. Kitts, not guaranteed that you're going to have a salary or guaranteed that you're going to have finance coming in unless you are elected? What inspired you to do so? I mean, give us the honest truth. And then my second question is, I know you went to Dubai with the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister. What was the reason for you going to Dubai, and what did you get off going to Dubai? What did you get out of going to Dubai that can assist the people in the Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis? And you have a pleasant day, sir, and I congratulate you, and I welcome you to the political arena in St. Kitts. You are a bright young man, and I know you for a while. I have been watching you, listening to you coming up, and I think you're going to make a great, great businessman or a great person within our Federation. I think you will help the Federation much more. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Valti. Oh, you said you know me, but clearly you don't, because you are suggesting that money is more important to me than the service of my country. Then clearly you do not know me. I would give up everything to see my St. Kitts and Nevis a better place. Full stop. Now let's deal with the insinuations that you have casted here. Number one, I was employed by Sol Petroleum, which is a regional company. I did not interview to go to Tortola. When I interviewed here, because of my experience and so on, they offered that position because my qualifications fit what they were looking for there. And it was a very good opportunity for me to do professional development. And it helped me tremendously because I was placed in a position of managing the operations. And that helped me tremendously as a professional. And I would encourage people to never think small-minded about their personal development. And I took the opportunity then to say, It will be good for me to for a 2 or 3 year time. Actually, I intended to be to do it for 3 years, but it hasn't been 3 years yet. So that I can have that opportunity to advance myself and become a more well-rounded professional. So that is why I took up the call that the company offered me to go there, because initially I was supposed to be working here with Sol and St. Kitts, right? So that's the first thing. Now, I don't know where you're getting your information from in terms of being well paid in Tortola, and I really don't have to deal with that. I was paid according to my qualifications. Now, what inspired me to come back and serve St. Kitts? I don't mind if I have to plant potato in my backyard if nothing is there. You have to understand, this is really significantly more than money or anything like that for me. And it's disheartening that we cannot believe that people are willing to serve for that. And so in this process, I've made it clear that I requested nothing, I received nothing in exchange to run for political office. Let me make that clear. I requested nothing, and I received nothing in exchange to run for political office in constituency number 3. I am doing this as all of my songs, all of my art in the Calypso field, all of my life has shown that I'm doing this out of a desire to one day that my children and my grandchildren can be in a significantly better place in a few years than we are now. You know, I have consistent and constant dreams of where I see my little federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. Everywhere I go, wherever I travel, I often ask myself why we can't be doing this, why we can't be doing that, you know, why we can't have a structured way of how, for example, we lay out our sidewalks, simple things like that. I'm always thinking about how can I better and how can I contribute to the advancement of my people. And this goes for the different things I see in constituency number 3. So I understand where your insinuations are coming from, but they are totally unfounded. And I'm doing this out of a real love for my country. Now, with respect to Dubai, I do not understand why Dubai raises so much concern and eyebrows. I've been a Calypsonian at the senior level now since 2005. I have traveled the world over and sung and performed as the reigning Calypso King in many, many events where you had the Prime Minister, where you had honorable ministers of government, where you had government officials and ambassadors from Toronto, in New York, in Washington, D.C., in Houston, in Miami, and in Dubai. What happened is the organizers of a particular dinner event came to St. Kitts last carnival and were so impressed with the performance that we gave last Christmas that they invited me as the reigning national king to perform at an event to showcase St. Kitts. I went there to perform as the reigning national king, and the Prime Minister happened to be the guest speaker at the event. The Prime Minister himself was unaware that I was going to be there. So let me make this categorically clear now. The Prime Minister did not invite me to go to Dubai. He did not pay me to go to Dubai. And he did not pay any part of my fear to go to Dubai. It was those organizers who all they wanted to do was showcase some talent to the persons there in Dubai of what we had in St. Kitts. And I was very honored for the call, and I hope they invite me again. Absolutely. And one more thing, while I was there, we were able to touch people that a gentleman from China said he wants me to come over and sing at his bar in China.
So China next?
China is next.
There you go. All right, it's 2:49. Let's go back and take some more calls. In the interest of time, good afternoon, caller. Thanks for waiting. You are on Issues.
I'm going to be very brief, Juni, because Conrad done started giving me some body blows. So I'm going to be very brief. I just want to contrast.
Deserving?
Yeah. I just want to contrast something by what Conrad has said and what others is saying about taking the vote as I'm taking the vote and giving it to others. Let me say between 93 and 95, we had some upheaval. 4-4, the leadership of the Labour Party went over to Nevis to negotiate with the CCM. And at that time, we're giving up every single vote that was cast in St. Kitts to the CCM in Nevis. Mr. Emery refused to become the Prime Minister, and that is a fact. Presently, NRP, Labour, and NIP singing the same song, and nobody's talking about that. So if Sam had a problem with the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister had a problem with him. And Sam decided to depart peacefully. What is wrong with that? You and I know, Juni, that the Prime Minister is a very difficult man to deal with. He wants all right. He wants all right. And it's hard, very hard, to accept anything that the Prime Minister say. He dilly-dally a lot. Dilly-dally, flip-flop a lot. And that's a fact. Have a nice day.
All right. Thank you, sir. Let's try another call here. Good afternoon, caller. You on the air?
Good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, King Konris.
Good afternoon to you, sir. And how are you?
I'm not doing too badly, thank you. I hope you are doing fine along with your family.
Yes, I'm doing okay.
Yeah, I have one question for you, King Konris.
Yes, sir.
Don't mind me calling you King Konris.
No, that's okay.
Do you believe in... let me see a better word to say. Do you believe in the checks and balances?
Did you say checks and balances?
In government, yes.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
I hope you do, and I know you do.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that call has dropped out. Let's take another one. Good afternoon, you're on the air.
Yeah, good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon, my dear.
Yes. I am calling to give Konris my blessing.
Thank you.
Konris, I know you. I watch you on the Lady Lawrence concert many times. I see you grow up. You're very decent and respectable young man. I pray God to give you the strength to go forth and do what you have to do to serve your country. It's a calling. You have a calling. Many people have calling in different ways. And this is your calling. And I revoke, I put God's blessings on you today. God be with you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much for that call. Let's take another call on the overseas line. Good afternoon. You're on the air.
Good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon.
I want to be the first to say, Konris, welcome. I see a new vision as Prime Minister of Nevis on the very close horizon. So welcome aboard. You are a vision, Konris. You got it in your blood. You told us that in your speech. We are looking to you for big things. And I think you have shown us in a very calm, collective way that you're quite capable. Please do not allow anybody to sidetrack you with questions about why you left a job, where you've been, or anything like that. It seems to me, no matter what you do, Konris, you have such a force to be reckoned with that you have caused, or you are causing, many sleepless nights. Be very careful. Tread carefully. Konris, I remember your grandfather. I know your grandmother. The visions are looking at you. So it's not only Saint Kitts, Konris. And we're looking to you for big things. We're expecting big things. You outlined a very ambitious track that you intend to go down with this. And we are praying for you. We are hoping and believing that you will be successful because you certainly have been a breath of fresh air. Quite frankly, you and the other two new candidates that have come on board, if I dare say Prime Minister Douglas, have set up an unstoppable force of candidates and a roster of candidates that are not in no way going to be easy to beat. Those who want to disrespect any especially young person coming on board by insinuating that they have been bribed, paid, moved back for whatever reason, I say shame on them. Keep your head focused, Konris. And let me repeat, I am going to be the first to congratulate a Nevisian Prime Minister. Have a good day.
All right, you have a good day yourself, and thanks for the call.
All right, thank you very much, caller. I appreciate the words of well wishes and so on. And, you know, yes, I am from Nevis heritage and so on. But just rest assured because, you know, my aim is not necessarily to supersede the processes that are in place in terms of how one develops in its political career. My emphasis now is squarely on addressing what has been a shortfall of the dealing with the issues in West Bastia. And yes, I want to see, for example, I'm a one who believes in the Federation, and I want to see us work together to ensure that the relationship between St. Kitts and Nevis continues to grow. So thank you for those kind words, and I'm humbled by your suggestions and your warmth.
Thank you
very much.
It's we just have just about 5 minutes left for this interview here on Issues with Konris Maynard. Let's go back to the line. Good afternoon, you're on.
Hi, good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mr. Maynard.
Good afternoon to you
I'm
as well.
I'm calling to wish you all the best.
Thank you.
The people of Palmetto Point are behind you 100%, and also the young labor rights, you know
we
have your back.
Yes, indeed.
They're already behind you. All right, so don't bother with them. All right, enjoy the rest of your afternoon.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you so much for that call. Let's take another one here. Good afternoon. You're on the air on Issues.
Good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I call you to congratulate you and thank you, Nevis, gracious young man. I can feel your heart, a heart of God. You explain yourself without anger. You didn't have to tell nobody where you went or what you went to do. But
all right, again, we're having some problems with that line. Let's take this one. Good afternoon, you're on the air.
Hello?
Good afternoon, you're on with Konris Maynard on Issues.
Good afternoon. First, I would like to commend Mr. Konris, the King, for an excellent performance so far. I heard him, even though he wasn't present at the talk with his constituents. It was excellent, and I'm looking forward to the what you call it now, the real stuff, the rally, your main rally. I'm looking forward to that. I've seen you indoors, and I'm looking forward to see you outdoors. You're back in your country, here's where you live, and you come back home. You don't bother with nobody. When Lindsay and Powell went to Dubai, anybody ask them any question what they went there for? But I'm happy that you clear it up. I wanted to do it, you know. But I said, let you do it yourself. Because I knew that you went there to perform. Thank you very much, sir. And all the best to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much for those encouraging words. And yes, but remember, this is the silly season of politics. And people will do and say all manner of things. But I have been trained well, and I have unwavering faith in God. So we will be fine.
All right. It's just about 2 minutes before the hour of 3 o'clock. My guest, and he has just about 2 minutes left on the program this afternoon. So we're going to take about two more calls, and then we're going to wrap it up. Good afternoon. You're on the air.
Yeah, good afternoon, Juni.
Good afternoon.
Open for questions, right?
Right. That's it. Right now, yes.
Somebody said, you know, certain questions can be asked. But earlier, the gentleman stated that a court did not say something is illegal. I want to know if something could only be illegal if a court says it is illegal. He was talking about when he's questioned about the illegitimate government, illegal. He said the court have not found them illegal. So I want to know if it's only if when a court finds somebody or something illegal, if it is illegal. I'd like to hear his response on that, please.
All right. While he ponders that, let's take this one quickly. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mr. Liburd, Lord, finally.
Finally, yes. Go ahead.
Yes.
Mr. Maynard,
yes.
In number three,
yes.
There's always been a division, them against us. What are your plans to unite the constituency together? And also, some time back, I don't know if I heard it or I read it. I think I saw your name somewhere mentioned in the renaming of to the back of the community center of the village, to name it the Earl Booth something, 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 and to recreate Pan in St. Kitts. I don't know if I heard it or I read it somewhere, but I think I saw your name somewhere along the line. The young people are basically going astray since Mr. Booth is no longer with us. Do you have any plans in your immediate agenda to address this issue? And also, the young people in Poland Division 6, most of them are jobless, not that they are not trying. You have anything in place that could address this situation? And also, I am all about my community, so most of my questions will be directed in that area.
Mm-hmm.
The school in my area where I work is in need of some dire help. I mean, you know this, because I've just been here recently. So I want to know what are your plans to get the community back together? What are you doing about the steel pan situation? Island-wide, it needs to go back island-wide in the high schools, etc., even in the primary school, maybe on the grade 6 level. And what do you intend to bring to the table that is different for the young people of my area?
All right. Thank you so much, Verlin, for all your questions in relation to constituency number 3. We're going to hear from Konris at this point. Konris?
Yes, thank you very much, Verlin Warner. And, you know, I really appreciate the love that you show for your community and to get things done. One of the things definitely that we can even do right away, we don't need government approval to do this, mm-hmm. is to rejuvenate community groups and community activities. I spoke about this in my speech. There is nothing stopping a representative from deciding that, hey, we need to have a community group that targets young women, for example. There's nothing to stop a sitting representative to say, hey, we need a community competition, for example, to clean up and beautify the area. And in my walks thus far, the young people are actually crying out for this. They're crying out for where is the community involvement. And that is what we're going to be focused on in the near future in terms of what activities and so on we can do. I named a few. We're going to look at, for example, basketball competitions, different sporting competitions. I spoke with one young man from the West Farm area. He said, you know, fishing competition, because a lot of the guys down there want to do fishing competition. They want to help in terms of beautifying the area. And these are things that the young people are saying. And there's nothing to stop us from proceeding with that. Now, with respect to the PAN group, I think maybe you have seen my name because I've helped them before in terms of arranging and being their mentor. This is after Boots had passed and so on. And you know, we went on. We almost won the competition. You know, we felt we had a very good shot. But I worked very hard with them and so on. And I am always accessible and available for things like that, even regardless of politics. This was before politics. And certainly, I've already spoken. Right now, they're trying to rejuvenate themselves. And we have already spoken. And we are going to move forward in terms of how I can be a part of that process. For example, we look at Village-O-Rama. That was a very, very good initiative to keep the community together, interested to communicate with each other, to lime and to socialize with each other and so on. And that is something that we could certainly look to do. I don't know if it's going to be possible for this year again, because we are already very close to the carnival season. But these are things that you can't tell me you were stopped from doing. And these are the things that the community want to see. And we have identified a lot of young people who are willing to come on board to be a part of these community initiatives. You also mentioned jobs for young people. One of the strategies that I think we need to look forward to is not necessarily providing only short-term jobs. We must provide the incentives for people to create their own businesses. I've spoken to a number of young men who have some brilliant ideas. They want to get into fishing, and they said, you know, Konris, if we could get X, Y, and Z, then I can hire 10 people, and we can do this. There's some people who want to get in plantaries, nurseries, to grow seedlings and so on and sell. They say, Konris, look, we just need a little assistance, a little direction, and if we do this, then I can hire 4 people. Same thing with landscaping. The young people have said, look, who is taking care of the maintenance of the school? We want to start a little group to a little business so that we can maintain the schools and so on. So all of these things are very, very possible. It just takes the will and the tenacity and, a certain love and care for the community to just see them through. These are not rocket science things, you know, that's for in university. These are things we could actually get done. So I do not accept anyone who is going to claim that you were stopped from doing these type of things. I will not be stopped. And we will get them done so that our young people can feel involved and our people in general, because a lot of these things, community activities and so on, will also bring the mature, older folks, middle-aged, all areas of our society. I mean, we could have community groups for the elderly so that they can socialize. We can identify what we can do so that they can be a part of the process and so on. It just takes a love for the community and a love to see people together and moving forward together with one common purpose. So I want to thank you for those very, very... poignant words, and we're going to work together, and I know I'm going to be working very closely with you to ensure that some of these things get done.
Konris, I want to thank you. That call from Verlin was our final call for this afternoon, and I want to end with this thought by Adina on the wall, who says, Konris, you are prepared for leadership, you are community minded, you have God in the midst, and everything will fall in place. I think that's a proper and fitting way to end issues for today. But before I go, I want to get your closing thoughts. We've discussed a lot this afternoon what motivated you to enter into the political arena down to the very issues, the salient issues of the day that our people are grappling with on a daily basis, especially in your constituency, number 3. So I want you to put a cap on it at this point and give me your closing thoughts as we close out this edition of Issues for Today.
Yes, thank you, Juni. I'm very honored and humbled to be a part of this process and to have decided to, really live up to the country's motto, country above self, and submit myself to the service of the people of West Bastia. We have sacrificed a lot. We have sacrificed a lot for many, many years towards the development of this country. And we feel that we may not necessarily have been given the right type of representation. And so we are adamant now that although we let that pass in times past, we feel a bit hurt that even given that pass, that someone would then try to give away what we voted for. We are saying no to that. We are saying that we are now in a position to be proud again, and that Konris, along with Labour, will look to win big for everyone. And I want to take this special opportunity to reach out to those people who feel that maybe they have moved away from the Labour fold. They feel they can't come because of maybe what they did before. We are welcoming you with open arms. We understand where your heart is. We understand what you're really feeling. And we believe that you see that something new and different and exciting is going to be happening in our constituency. And you want to be part of winning big for your community. So we invite you to come on board. And I encourage those of us who may have been hurt by what has been happened, we need to tame those feelings and make sure that we welcome everyone. Spear no one, brand no one, love everyone. We must be the party of true love. And as I said, not puppy love, not a love that will wear off in a few weeks or a few months, a love that is eternal. And so let's come together. and let's really try for once to work as a community and build up our people. Even if it's one at a time, we want to build up our people. And so I'm here, and I'm letting the constituents know that I am here to win big for you. I've submitted myself to you and in service of seeing a better and brighter day for my people and the people of constituency number 3. So I want to say God bless the people of constituency 3, God bless the people of St. Kitts and Nevis, and God bless my federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. And I want to thank Juni for having me on, and I look forward to sharing many
your family more. We love to have you here.
Yes, great. Thank you very much, Juni, and thank you to the listening public. God bless.
Thank you so much, and we certainly extend sincere best wishes to you for a productive future as you go out on life's pathway, political pathway, to help benefit and better the lives of the people, not only of constituency number 3, but the entire federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Thank you. But that's